It makes it an easy life rather than a struggling life.
Is that because as children we're subject to direct belief?
Yes.
Yeah, we just accept a lot of what we're told.
Right. Children, we've got people that are telling us everything. We've got our parents, and if they had a struggling childhood, they're going to influence us toward that struggling childhood. If they have a struggling adulthood, that will continue on into the adults, unless the child is strong enough to say, wait a minute, that's not going to fit me. I'm not going to do that. And remove that from their own belief system. Our belief systems rule how our lives are going to be.
So one of the prayers could be for the audience, for example, for God, or I don't know how you do your prayers, to remove false belief systems that are not empowering their lives.
Correct. I like to use for myself any belief that I have that limits me in any way is dissolved, completely gone. I will not be limited in any way. I choose to accept life, abundance, happiness, peace of mind, joy, and all the things that create happy people.
And how many times should people say that?
Until they believe it. Which for some people who have been given this struggling belief system, it's going to take a lot of affirmations of that sort to finally get them out until they have two or three things that happen in their life that they feel like calling luck. And when they can begin to say, you know, I've been pretty lucky in the last 6 weeks, they'll begin to believe that whatever they learned earlier is not true. And so it changes their whole subconscious in there.
You know, speaking of luck, there was a project, a study done on luck. And one of the findings that came out of the study on luck is that people who thought they were lucky were. They had more luck than anybody else.
Right.
If they said, I'm so lucky, or they come from that they're lucky, that belief actually created more synchronicity, more things happening and popping. And I think it was done out of England.
Uh-huh.
Isn't that interesting?
According to your beliefs, it is done unto you. According to your beliefs, it is done unto you.
So you've worked with a lot of people over God knows how many years, over 30 years.
Yes.
What are the biggest breakthroughs you've seen relative to the focus of money in your career?
I have seen people come out of poverty. People with no jobs, no futures, no abilities to think of themselves as anything but beaten and downtrodden. And when they can come out of that and say, whoops, wait a minute, and they can do that if one good thing happens to them that they can put their faith in. But they have to, in some way, create a situation in their life that they know is going to be a winner. And a lot of people have started, and it's sort of a ridiculous way to look at it, but it works, by asking for things like parking places. I always have a parking place right in front of where I want to park. Somebody's just coming out as I want to put my car in. And after saying this for several days, it happens.
What allows that to happen? What is that? Is that a synchronization with the universe? What is that?
You're at the right place at the right time to be lucky, if you believe you're lucky. If you want to change who you are and what you are, you begin to claim that. And luck is one of the best ways, because some of it makes no sense. You know, a place where cars are backed up for half a mile trying to find a parking place, to all of a sudden, the person right in front of you is backing out and you're the only one there, that's luck. Assumed luck. It's not. It's because you have a belief that somewhere you can find a parking place. It's going to be exactly where you want it to be. It's going to be convenient for you. It's going to be plenty of room to get your car in there. And it's now. And that will work for you. That's the way we begin to start believing that the world is assisting us instead of the world being against us.
Talk about also why it is that in New Thought that there is this paradigm about God or the universe being the endless supplier. That when we look to the world of supply, the things, the manifest world, if we see lack somewhere or need somewhere, we buy into the physical manifestation of what we see with our eyes in the natural.
Right.
But that's not what the New Thought paradigm is. The New Thought paradigm has to do with the universe being the supplier. Can you explain that as a key to manifesting money?
When we're giving affirmations to people and telling them how to change their life and how to make things happen in their life, one of the things that we tell them is don't outline. Don't tell the universe how you're going to get it. You have to have, this is what I choose to have in my life, show me the way. And you open the doors for the unexpected. When we set a limit on how it has to come through, Uncle Joe or Uncle Aunt Susie has to give me the money for a new car or anything of that sort, we limit the way the universe can give to us. We cut out everything, every other opportunity that we might have, including money coming into us.
The business model, so interesting, is all about planning and knowing ahead of time and trying to control and outline everything all in front and how you're going to get it done. And this is one of the reasons, in my view, by the way, why the venture capital world is absolutely stuck and immobile, meaning that so many more ventures would be funded if they based their funding criteria not based on how it's all going to be made to happen, but based on other criteria. It's very interesting. It's like there's a lockdown on manifestation.
Yes. And our ideas are that it's struggle. We have to find a way. And we don't. We just have to ask, claim it, say it, and be open and receptive to the many wonderful ways that we can demonstrate things.
There's a piece that I found very interesting in one of your articles. I think Catherine also talked about this too, but it talked about when you're in the midst of bringing something through or calling it in that you want, that's dear to your heart, there's a recommendation not to tell and talk about it with others.
Right.
Talk about that. I think that's very critical. And actually, that's the advice that poets and artists have taken on, to not dissipate the energy of what they're doing and what they're receiving. But talk about that.
Okay. When we tell what we want to people who doubt, they're going to put their doubt out into the universe. And if they tell us, you don't really believe that's going to happen, it will create doubt in us.
Right. As a reinforcer, correct?
And so you get a few of those doubts stuck in your head that you are not able to overcome, or people talk about it. People will say, you know, I heard that Ann say the other day that this was what she was going to do, and there's no way. Then maybe she tells 10 people. Then those 10 people are going to say, well, there's no way she can do it. She's going to be disappointed in that. And that 10 tells another 10, and that, you know, and it just goes on and on and on. So things that you want, things that you're planning to do, you keep quiet and tell only those people who are supportive of you and who understand the responsibilities of what we are doing when we start making our claims and begin to manifest these ideas.
I have to tell you something interesting I learned as a young child that's very much attuned to what you're describing. I was a tournament tennis player that began my career with a gentleman named Michael Amador, who had to leave the city after about a year of coaching me and introduced me to a champion named Pancho Segura, greatest coach of my life. And he had another student he was working with named Jimmy Connors. And Jimmy Connors used to walk onto the court, I kid you not, saying, I'm the greatest. I'm the greatest. I'm a champion. I'm the greatest. It was like wild. It was almost like Muhammad Ali. But I have to tell you, this guy emanated the greatest championship energy. He took full possession of that part of the sport.